You may now take off your face mask if you would like to do so. And I will remind you that if you do need to get up to use the restroom or any other emergency, to make sure you put your face mask back on and fully cover your nose and your mouth. And also make sure if you're walking within 6 feet of anyone as you walk out, to give them a chance to put their masks on as well. But we do hope that you'll be here with us in the same seat for the whole rest of the worship service, and I welcome each and every one of you to worship today. I'm Alan Akana, the Kahu pastor of the church, and it is so good to see everyone. I don't think we have any first-time visitors, but just in case I might be missing someone, we do have a gift for you if you are a first-time visitor. And as a reminder, we have changed our rules a little bit in terms of now that people are getting vaccines, and so make sure you're aware of those, which are on the big board as you the sandwich board, I guess it's called, as you walked in from the parking lot, and it's also on our website, and just be aware of those. And then in terms of our temporary worship guidelines, those are pretty much the same on the top of page 5. And I will remind everyone, if you have been blessed by our ministry and would like to make a gift to the church, you can do so either after the service, placing it in the offering bowl or in one of the baskets in the front by the front door. Or you can also do that online, of course. A couple quick announcements. We are having our church virtual breakfast on Tuesday morning at 8 o'clock, and that information is all on our weekly news, and so just check that, and if you by chance would like to join us and don't get the weekly news, just contact the church office tomorrow or see Penny today, and we'll make sure that we get you all set up for that. It's basically just a time to gather together and visit, really no agenda except to kind of catch up and have good conversation with each other. And we do look forward to the day when we can actually gather together and eat a real breakfast. But in the meantime, just bring your coffee or your tea or anything else you'd like and join in on the conversation. And then also, it's very exciting to announce that beginning next week, we have an exercise wellness class for seniors. And Rose Tatiana will be leading that. And it'll be after church, typically 3 Sundays a month, and it's very limited due to the pandemic, and last I heard it's just about filled up anyway, but if you are interested in this class on Sundays after church, contact Rose, and normally you could just see her today, but I know she had a huge halau event yesterday with her halau and was up pretty late last night and said, don't plan on seeing me this morning because I'm going to be up most of the night cleaning up and doing things like that. So Anyway, but it's just a really good thing that Rose is doing for us. I believe that's it for the announcements that we need to cover today, and I would remind you that we're still in the season of Easter. It's the fourth Sunday of Easter on the Christian calendar, and today the theme is God as our shepherd and Jesus as the good shepherd. And I will just let you sit with that for just a moment as we begin our worship service today.
Aloha. Come, let us worship God, who fulfills all of our deepest longings, who gives us rest and nourishment, who leads us in paths of peace and righteousness. For even when we walk in darkness and shadows, we need not fear, for God is always with us. And God comforts us in both fear and pain. Let us offer thanks and praise to God, for being in God's presence is like enjoying a great banquet where we recognize our many blessings. Wherever we choose to go, God's grace and mercy go with us. They are with us now and will remain with us for the rest of our lives. Let us pray. God of grace and mercy, you are like a shepherd to us, a shepherd who loves us more than we can imagine. We give you thanks for your great compassion for all your children and ask that you open our hearts so that we may, in turn, share your love with all. Open our eyes as we worship today so that we may recognize and acknowledge the ways we resist your grace, and free our spirit so that we may then fully live in your unbridled and wondrous love. Amen. Today's Old Testament reading is the 23rd Psalm. Listen for the word of God. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. The Lord makes us lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. The Lord restores my soul and leads me in the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valleys, I fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Today's gospel reading is from John chapter 10, verses 11 through 18. Listen for the word of God. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for his sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd, does not own the sheep, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and runs away. And the wolf snatches them and scatters them. The hired hand runs away because a hired hand does not care for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not belong in this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Father loves me, because I lay down my life in order to take up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down upon my own accord. I have power to lay it down, and I have the power to take it up again. I have received this command from my Father. May God bless the reading of the word, and may our hearts be open to receiving it.
Aloha, everyone. I'm Chris, and this is
Michelle.
My wife, Michelle, and we're going to be singing a song from a band called Kansas. It's called Dust in the Wind. When we were asked to think of a song, I really couldn't think of one, and I thought about my mom used to force us to read the Bible every morning, and one of her biggest heroes was King Solomon. And so she said, out of all of the things that Solomon could ask for, he asked for wisdom. And despite having this amazing wisdom, when you look at the book of Ecclesiastes, it always just kind of leaves you thinking about, huh, what's there? So I'm not sure how this song will speak to you, but I hope in some way that it does speak to you and that you're blessed by it.
I close my eyes only for a moment, and a moment's gone. All my dreams pass before my eyes, a curiosity.
Began learning about sheep in 1994 when I moved from Honolulu to Miles City, Montana. Pretty much everything I'd learned about sheep before that was what I learned in Sunday school or church, especially when someone would read the 23rd Psalm or talk about Jesus as the Good Shepherd. And those are both of our scripture lessons today. So as I can remember back to childhood and my teenage years and early adult years, I always felt so good about being a sheep. And then I moved to eastern Montana. So Miles City was known at one time for being a place where sheep are raised. In fact, in 1876, the first herd of sheep in eastern Montana was in Miles City, and it just grew from there and grew and eventually became the number two livestock in terms of number of animals after cattle. And I think at this point still it's like number seven or eight in the country in terms of state with the most number of sheep. And I just remember leaving Honolulu and arriving in Miles City. And it seemed like every single country road out of town, didn't matter which direction you went, you were bound to see herds of sheep within minutes. The other thing I remember was eastern Montana is very unlike the terrain of Hawaii. It's also very unlike the terrain of western Montana. And as you guys were singing Dust in the Wind, I kept going back there. It's a very dusty, flat, dry place for most of the year. Well, anyway, some of the members of my church were sheep ranchers. And it was either the first or second spring that we were there. I thought, oh, this is going to be so nice. I'm going to take Polani, my son, who was two or three at the time, out to one of these places and show him the lambs just after they're born. Probably it was April. At the time, right around Easter, and I thought, oh, how appropriate and how wonderful. And so I was talking to one of the sheep families of our church, and they said, oh, we're having so many lambs right now. It's lambing season in boy, just bring out Polani anytime. And every day we've got new lambs being born. So I was so excited for him to see these adorable little lambs. And as soon as we got there, we walked into this gigantic barn. And in the barn were all these stalls where the ewes were birthing. And there were little lambs all over in there as well as outside. And we saw the church member and walked right over to him. He was kind of laying on the ground next to a ewe. What we didn't know as we walked into the barn is the ewe had just given birth to a stillborn. So there was this dead lamb on the ground right in front. And as I'm walking over towards it and I'm looking down at Polani, I realize that that's not exactly what I brought him there to see. So we just made a quick, turn to the left, and we looked at the live lambs and basically got to see all these adorable little creatures. And I felt like, oh, I saved the day. I was paying attention to what happened and didn't have to expose him to a poor dead baby lamb. Well, right after we were checking out some of the little lambs, the church member that was with the ewe came over and basically, as a matter of fact, just said, "Yep, you save some and you lose some. Every year during the season, we lose some of the lambs and we also lose some of the ewes. And you just know if you're going to do this kind of work, that's part of the package." And he just said it so matter-of-factly, and I was still kind of upset. I'd never seen a dead lamb before. And I was really upset that I almost showed it to Polani, a little, two- or three-year-old. But it occurred to me there's a lot about sheep that I really didn't know. And so I decided just to keep my eyes open and learn what I could while I was there in Montana for about 3 years serving a church in Miles City. Well, I'll just tell you, one of the things I learned is that caring for sheep is hard work. It's definitely not for the faint-hearted and for the weak. In fact, during lambing season, people rarely slept. They stayed up all night with the ewes birthing lambs and making sure that they were cared for. It was also very messy work. It was work that had virtually no guarantee of life or death. And I remember thinking back then, I don't think I'm cut out for that, but I'm glad there's other people who are. I also learned a lot about sheep in particular when I was there. And one of the things that I learned right away is that sheep don't make very good parents. And the ewes, I noticed, it was almost like they ignored their little lambs. And I remember asking, is this normal? It's like, oh, this is just normal behavior. And then just this week, I wanted a little refresher. So I Googled, sheep ranching in Montana. And I found out that my perceptions back then were pretty true for people who hung out with sheep very regularly. In other words, other sheep herders. And I actually wrote down a quote that I'm going to read to you in just a moment. And it just goes to show that sheep, the ewes, the mothers, are really not very good parents at all. So this is from somebody who works with sheep and has worked with many different animals in terms of ranching. And here's what this person said. Sheep have the least maternal instinct of any critter I've dealt with. They're always having more lambs than they've got milk for, losing track of their babies, rejecting their lambs, sometimes killing them, and generally refusing any assistance you may try to give them. Wow. I also learned that if the mothers, the ewes, are not good mothers, the rams are horrible fathers. They have no sense of protecting the family or caring for the family at all. And as I was watching these sheep, it also occurred to me, and this was affirmed from talking to people, that they're just dumb. I mean, they're so cute. I mean, it just seems almost mean to call them unintelligent because they're so darn cute. But they're adorable, but they're dumb. In fact, as I learned more about sheep, I thought, it's amazing that any even exist anymore. And the only reason I'm convinced that there are sheep in this world is because there are good shepherds who care for these dumb animals that would probably be completely extinct thousands of years ago if it wasn't for human beings that cared enough to really take care of them. So they're not good parents. They're not good family members. They're dumb. And I just remember thinking, there's got to be some redeeming qualities about them as a species besides just what they do for human beings. But frankly, I couldn't think of much at all. They also seem to have no sense whatsoever of independent thinking. I mean, they can think, oh, I'm hungry, I'm going to go and eat. But if you're leading a whole bunch of sheep from one pen to another, and the first sheep sees a shadow on the ground, or a leaf that happens to blow just a little bit, or anything at all, a stick that wasn't there before, that sheep will jump about this high off the ground. And of course, every other sheep that comes along, even though there's no reason to jump, every other sheep jumps when they get there. And you can just watch one sheep after another, after another, after another. It's like they have no sense of saying, there's no reason to jump anymore. It's like, well, one sheep does it, all the sheep do it. So I want to tell you, after living in eastern Montana, I am not happy at all being referred to as a sheep. I had no problem with that before I moved there. And then I spent time with sheep and I thought, no. I do not like this analogy at all. But nevertheless, God is called a shepherd. The Lord is my shepherd. And Jesus is called the good shepherd. And so I thought, well, we got to work with this a little bit because it's in the scripture. And if God and Jesus are the shepherd, by implication, we are sheep whether we like it or not. So, as I think about sheep, I can definitely see some commonalities, either in myself or in other people. But there's something in me that just bristles immediately when somebody calls somebody else an animal of any kind other than a human being. Immediately I think, oh, here comes the dehumanization. And if you think about it, when you are asked to think what kind of animal you are, you might think of animals with good qualities. But typically when you hear people calling somebody a name of another animal, it's not usually in a positive sense at all. Think about that. The last time you heard somebody refer to somebody else as an animal, it probably wasn't very positive. Now, when I was at a retreat many years ago, at a retreat center up in the mountains in California, I remember the retreat leader saying, I want you all just to sit in quiet for a moment and imagine what animal in the world you identify with the most. And it was all positive. Somebody was an eagle because the eagle soared and could see all over it, the wide range view, but could still see little tiny things really clearly. And they either saw themselves in that way or that was their aspiration. They wanted to be more like that. Somebody else saw themselves as a wolf because the wolf was fast and the wolf was sleek and the wolf was strong. And somebody said, I actually see myself as a dolphin because dolphins are playful and they're fast and, you know, they can outswim a shark and on. But I realized as I was listening to all these people come up with all these animal identifications for themselves that it was always positive. But I kept trying to think about what words do we typically use in terms of animal language for other people that is usually positive. And I couldn't come up with a whole lot. You can probably think of some of those words yourself. Now, as I was just pondering this past week, I thought, you know, over human history, people have called other people the names of animals to dehumanize them. And think about snake, leech, rat, I'm sure you can think of many, many others. And in its extreme form, people have called each other animals in order to wipe them out, to actually kill them. During the Holocaust, Jews were referred to as vermin. During the great period of colonization, people of indigenous blood were called apes and monkeys and were treated no better than that. Over and over throughout history, people have used animals to dehumanize other people. But as I thought about what it would mean for Jesus to think of us, to think of other human beings as sheep, I really can't tell you all that was on his mind because it doesn't really say. But I will tell you that like sheep, I've noticed at least a few human beings doing and saying some pretty dumb things, including myself. I thought, okay, I can kind of identify with a sheep. We've all said some pretty stupid things that we've regretted and done things we thought, oh, that was just dumb. I can think of other things that I can say, well, that's kind of like a sheep. There's times where I'm not all that loving. I've seen other human beings say things that are extremely unloving. Whether it's in their own family or community or nation or world, it's like, yeah, I get it. We can be like sheep. And then there's that whole thing about sheep not thinking on their own 2 feet, not thinking about, this is who I am, and even if the whole flock is thinking this or doing that, I can be different. I see so many people just going with the flow. And I know that you can probably think of things that you've heard on the news or on Facebook or other social media just in the last week or so where you think people are just spewing out what other people are saying, whether there's any truth to it or not. We, my friends, can be an awful lot like sheep. But you know, as you read this passage, the focus really isn't so much on the sheep when you look at John's gospel. When Jesus says, I am the good shepherd. And the same thing with the 23rd Psalm, the Lord is my shepherd. The focus is on God, and more particularly on God's grace. You see, the sheep didn't do anything to deserve the care and compassion of the shepherd. The focus is just the fact that that shepherd took care of those sheep because that's what shepherds do. The sheep could be not very loving and dumb and just going along with peer pressure with all the rest of the crowd, even though it's not the right thing to do. The shepherd just keeps loving. And that's really the message for us today, isn't it? We can look at the things that we've said and done that are dumb and things we've said and done that are unloving. And we can think of the things that we've just gone along with because that's what everyone else is saying or doing. And we just know, if we have faith in God the way Jesus presents God, that God loves us anyway. God loves us completely. God loves us unconditionally. God loves us throughout our lives and actually throughout eternity. The part about the passage from John's gospel that I think many of us might have a little bit of a challenge with is that part where Jesus says, I have other sheep. And the idea is, Jesus tells his disciples, I have other sheep that are also part of my flock, but he tells them nothing about who those other sheep are, what they look like, where they're from, how to identify them. And the disciples must have thought, well, how will we know when we come across these other sheep? And I think Jesus very intentionally didn't want us to know. In fact, there's a story, maybe you've heard this story before, but and there's various variations of it, but there's a story that really helps me to understand why Jesus didn't want us to know who those other sheep are. And in this story, there's a church similar to ours, and this church, however, had been declining in numbers for many, many years. And people couldn't figure out why people kept leaving the church and scratching their head and saying, we used to have dozens of kids in Sunday school and hundreds of people showing up. And they contacted the denomination and said, help us. And the denomination sent out a consultant who gave them all sorts of things to do and try. And it just seemed like nothing worked. And one day, as the two passages that we read this morning from the 23rd Psalm and the Gospel of John were read, there was a lady that typically sat way back in the corner that didn't speak very much. And she was listening and thinking, yeah, I get it. The Lord is my shepherd. Jesus is the good shepherd. But that part about Jesus having other sheep in his flock was really bothering her, because she thought, I don't know who they are. What if God sends one of those other sheep into our church or to my home or across the path where I'm walking and I don't realize it and I don't treat that person with love and respect? How will I know? And this was really troubling her throughout the rest of that particular Sunday after she heard the passage read in church and heard a sermon on it. And that night, when she went to bed, she was still thinking about it. It was still bothering her. She had a hard time falling asleep. Well, eventually she fell asleep, and just before she woke up in the morning, she was awoken by this very vivid dream, perhaps the most vivid dream she's ever had before. And in this dream, Jesus appeared to her. And as she looked at Jesus' face, he said, "My child, what is troubling you?" And she said, "Well, Jesus, you say that there's other sheep that are part of your flock, but I have no idea who they are, and I want to make sure I treat them well. It's really bothering me. I want to know who they are." And Jesus just said, "Just imagine every single person walking into your life is one of those sheep. Treat them as if they're one of my flock." And that's the whole point. Well, the woman woke up, and somehow there was this transformation that had happened because of this dream she had. Well, actually, before she woke up, she had been looking into the eyes of Jesus as he was speaking, and then after he finished speaking, she looked down towards his feet and noticed thousands upon thousands upon thousands of sheep. Of all different colors, there was black sheep and white sheep and brown sheep and spotted sheep and sheep that had so many different colors you couldn't even identify them to a particular color. And there was big sheep and small sheep, old and young and fat and thin and on and on. And she just realized all these different sheep represent the people that I encounter every single day. So anyway, she wakes up and she's transformed, as I said. And the interesting thing is, everybody noticed. The next Sunday, she came to church and people just thought, she seems different. She's got a little more joy than I've ever seen her have before. She just seems to be more aware. And when I speak to her, she's paying attention to me like I'm the only person in the world. And so people started asking her, "Something's changed within you. What is it?" And she told them about the dream. And of course, as the story goes, people started catching on, and they all started realizing, boy, if we all treated every single human being out there as if they are one of Jesus' other sheep, just think of how much better the world would be. And imagine where the world would be today if we had all been doing that for the last 2,000 years. Well, that really is the message, isn't it? The message of those other sheep. We're not supposed to know exactly who they are. We're supposed to assume every other person is one of those other sheep of Jesus. Now, as I was telling you earlier, it bristles me a bit when someone refers to me as a sheep or any animal for that matter. But I think the real issue here is that we should all be bristled by the fact that we probably all have not treated some of Jesus' other sheep with the same kind of compassion and care and respect that we would have if we knew that that is a human being loved and adored by God just as much as I am. So I'm going to invite you to sit with that for a moment and think about all the sheep out there that are different colors, different sizes, different abilities, different cultures, different religions, and imagine knowing that that human being out there, that other person, is loved and adored just as much as you are by God. And how might you treat them differently because of that? Amen. It's now time for the sharing of joys and concerns, and it looks like we've got at least one card here. And this is from Nancy, and it says, Judy Conwell, surgery on her neck was successful, and she's able to move. So that's the joy, or able to move to rehab. And the concern is a veteran lost a younger brother, 33 years old, and a sister, 29 years old, a week after contracting corona. The youngest brother, 24, is struggling because he's brought the virus into the home. That is a good reminder for us, I think, that there are people out there that are really struggling with death, with illness, with spreading the virus, and the guilt, especially for those who have thought this really isn't that big of a deal anymore now that so many of us have been vaccinated. So along with these prayers of joy and concern, I will just say I would ask you all to pray for our country and for places in the world that are even much worse than ours. For example, India, the number of cases there and the deaths have just been literally unbelievable. It's hard for me to wrap my head around just how bad it is. And also just to invite people to get vaccinated and to care for others and to be as safe and as loving as possible. Also, I wanted to let you know that Faye is recovering at home now and came through her surgery, and we rejoice with that, but also ask for prayers for her continued recovery. She had shoulder replacement, and it's painful, so we continue to pray for her comfort. And also to Belinda, who's caring for Mom. Also, we heard from Sharon Mahaffey, who was able to have surgery this past week, and Sharon came through and is recovering, I believe, in Honolulu for now, and we're just waiting to hear, or they're waiting to hear, I guess, from the doctor in terms of when she can come back home, and also just to see if the cancer has spread anymore. Another prayer that we got just yesterday, Becky Sakimai's father, I believe, has appendicitis and is probably either having surgery right now or has just finished surgery, and Becky just texted yesterday to ask that we would pray for her dad, Carl. Also, Gail Bryan's sister Wendy was diagnosed with melanoma and awaiting results to see if it's metastasized. So Gail actually went back to California to spend some time with her sister and sent me a note this past week just asking for all of us to pray for Wendy. And then just this morning I found out Steve Sparks had surgery this past week, and I don't have any other details except I believe he's home and just asked for prayers. So that's what I have for now. And also I would invite you to remember all of the prayers that are listed on page 7 and continue to praying to be praying for one another throughout the week, and let us know if you have any additions that you would like for us to share with the congregation. As we pray, let us pause for just a moment in silence and feel God's loving presence among us and within us. Let us pray. Oh God, as we lift our prayers up to you, we begin by giving you thanks for the good news and the blessings that we've received this last week, especially the good news of all those who have come through surgery, and so far things have looked very successful. God, we give you thanks for the doctors, the nurses, and all the care that the people we love have received. And now as they continue to recover and recuperate, we ask for comfort, for peace, and for full healing. God, we pray for those who are having surgery today and in the days to come, for the same thing, for success, for peace, for comfort, and for healing. God, we also know that there are many people who are struggling emotionally, especially those we lift up to you today who have lost loved ones to COVID-19 recently, those who are feeling a great sense of loss, those who are feeling a great sense of guilt, those who are just in grief and in shock. Oh God, we pray for them all and pray for their comfort and for their own healing. And for those who continue to contract COVID-19, we pray for healing. We pray for places in our country and in this world where there are great surges, and pray that there would continue to be vaccinations available for more and more people all the time, and that people would get vaccinated and be healthy and have compassion for one another. God, we also know that in our country there has been a lot of discomfort, injustice, violence, and even great tragedy in many different communities. And God, we pray for peace. We pray for compassion for people in all those communities, and also for the leaders, including the elected leaders of each of those communities, as well as our state and national leaders. God, give them all your wisdom and compassion. I thank you also, oh God, for voices who do speak up when injustices are seen. Injustices regarding people of other races and ethnicities. Injustices toward women. Injustices toward LGBTQ communities, injustices to the earth. And God, during this week, as we have celebrated Earth Day once again, we pray for healing of this planet, for her climate, her water, her air, the plants and animals. And God, on this little tiny island in the middle of the Pacific, and for all of the Hawaiian Islands, we pray, oh God, for earth justice. And as we know that there are so many flowers and trees and birds and insects that are disappearing before our very eyes, and so many that have become extinct even in our lifetime. Oh God, open our hearts and our minds to understand this world with all of its beauty, its creativeness, its diversity, and embrace it all as you have, ever since you have created each and everything that there is. And God, now as this prayer comes to a close, we ask that you open our eyes to see in each and every person we encounter this week your Holy Spirit, your loving presence, in the fact that you do indeed have other sheep who are very different from us. And may we love them. May we respect them. May we honor them. And we pray all these things in the name of our faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Just making sure the mic is on. We're going to do a song called Rise Up, and we hope you enjoy it.
You're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can't find the fighter, but I see it in you. We gon' walk it out, move mountains. We gon' walk it out and move arise like the day, arise up, arise unafraid, arise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. And I'll rise up high like the waves, I'll rise up in spite of the ache, I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you, when the silence is quiet and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe, and I know you feel like dying, but I promise you we'll take the world to its feet and move mountains, bring it to its feet, and move mountains. And I'll rise up, I'll rise like the day, I'll rise up and play, and I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you, thousand times again. And I'll rise like the day, I'll rise up in spite of the ache, we'll rise up, and we'll do it a thousand times again. For you
Just a moment, I'm going to ask all of you to rise up, but before you do that, would you please take out your face mask and make sure that it fully covers your nose and your mouth. And as a reminder, we are still a no-touch community, and as hard as it is not to hug people, we would just ask that you do shakas or peace be with you or a bow or something where you're not touching. And now I invite you to stand for the benediction. And as we prepare to leave this place, may we always remember that the Good Shepherd goes with us, and the Good Shepherd has other sheep, and you will encounter them today as soon as you see the first person after you leave the church property. May we treat them with all the respect and love that God has for us. And may the love of God, the grace of our Savior Jesus Christ, and the comfort and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us and with all people now and forever. Amen. Go in peace.